I received the strangest message from Anthony Enyan Brown. He's president of the absolutely corrupt Stark County Bar Association that's speciously holding daycare files. And I won't even begin to specify the other possible holdings, properties, and construction affiliations. So less formally, Tony Brown, this is for you. I had sent you a cease and desist communication in December of 2019 as you were harassing me and attempting to conceal crimes. Your initial contact identified as representation to the notoriously corrupt Altman Hospital as a result of me simply requesting an audit of individuals who access my medical records with solid suspicions of parallel construction. Easy peasy, right? One would think, but who is Altman's compliance manager? Tim Regula. Regula is related to my rapist. And who is the sane sexual assault nursing examiner? Oh, that would be Jennifer Oliver, who's married to Chief Oliver, who mysteriously ordered an ambush to my domicile in Ohio with a social worker and two officers. Sound familiar? Crazy making, CPS, kids for cash. Now, what warranted that extreme action? Get this, an anonymous letter from a Masonic-affiliated woman who makes this her hobby. She's done this to other people and destroyed lives where they had to get new cars and new homes. We know it's her. Federal agents confirmed this, as well as the local police, but there's nothing they can do. We know why. This is Sheila, again with quite the history, who is seemingly exempt from laws with her suspicious group affiliations. Think about this for a moment. She joined my church divorce support group, to which I led after I was convinced by my rapist that I should quit because it hurt his feelings. It seemed to be more of a dating group. Yeah, I fell for that one. No judgment. She, along with a social worker, seemed to be planted to garner information from the divorce case of a high-profile CPA who was represented by my rapist law firm, Day Ketterer. They used information collected by these two women in court and even called some of the members to testify against our own members. Then Sheila, who I didn't know at the time as I had departed from the group, meets someone attending who has elderly parents living two doors from me and weasels her way into becoming their live-in aide. Keep in mind, this elderly couple with whom I was very close said she was evil numerous times. Think about the methodical nature to do this. My rapist had to conspire for years. He was caught meeting with her, my employer, the Ohio Attorney General Office, Mike McPhillips, to plot my demise and destruction in ways unfathomable to the human mind. I began to recollect that I found an email from a similar woman in his car, which for all intents and purposes gave the impression to be conspiring to try to implicate his second of four ex-wives in her own barn fire. There are rings within rings, and these networked women seem to attain promotions, judgeships, jobs, accolades for their cooperation. And this was apparent when my privacy-protected emails asking for assistance after my rape to other women, some of whom were members of women advocacy groups, were forwarded to my rapist law firm. I either vaguely knew or had never heard of these women. I couldn't understand why until I studied Masonic women. These members can always expect employment and protection by this cabal. In the male groups that these Masonic organizations have created are no different. The funding for these Fatherhood Commission initiatives is mind-numbing at the local, state, and federal levels. Gullible men fall for these psyops, just like the women believe in these empowerment organizations.
Thank you.
The mystery Babylon church funding is equally daunting. Again, Masons have infiltrated the boards of all agencies, organizations, schools, and nonprofits. A quick analysis of the domestic violence boards validates these suspicions. At this point, I'm not averse to closing all nonprofits, foundations, PACs, etc. It's to the point a new slate must be created. And if the second coming doesn't occur first, all future organizations must be sagaciously dissected to determine its true worthiness of such funds. This is Akron, Canton, Ohio. It's not California cost of living. And this is only one of thousands of analyses I've completed. It's divide and conquer with all races, genders, religions, and politics, which is leading us to their ultimate divide and conquer objective. One world religion, one androgynous gender, and a one world order. Love wins will be the hashtag of choice. Is that what we want? Is that what Yah intended for us? To be clear, I'm not anti anyone. I'm anti-agenda. The ambush team was sent to intimidate me and to try to get me to sign off on my medical records. Funny thing is this is approximately the seventh time different agencies, courts tried getting me to unlawfully sign off on my privacy protected rights, which just confirms my suspicions of parallel construction. So we all know that no medical records can be used if it was obtained
illegally because of spoliation of evidence.
But they don't want to supply who had access. Wonder why.
The same judge who touted his privacy rights was caught unlawfully demanding my medical records with no ruling on the dismissal, a prematurely scheduled CMC with no answer from the colluding Stark State College and its pay-to-play attorneys, Brennan, Manna, and Diamond, etc., etc. This judge was caught in all sorts of lies and racketeering and said this premature order for access to my medical records, violating my unalienable rights, was common in his court. After a thorough meta-analysis of his similarly situated cases over several years to which I secured, it was validated that it was only my case where this occurred. In fact, one other case that didn't involve me, he stated he was not going to require the sexual assault victim to disclose medical records until the liability portion of the case. Guess who the attorney was for the victim in this particular case? My rapist's attorney, who is a part of this quid pro quo system.
So with no ruling on the dismissal, it would be absolutely ludicrous to sign off on my medical records. And his scheduling of this conference with no judge ruling and no defended answer continued to solidify my conjectures that someone or someones had already accessed my medical records, but they needed to attain it in a non-criminal manner. The Stark County Sheriff tried to sneak in the opportunity in some paperwork. Stark State College also tried it numerous times. The state courts, with my rapist suing me for reporting with an oathless judge, also tried. Nonprofits tried. And now the federal judge, Adams, was hellbent on retrieving these records at the very beginning stages of litigation, where, quite frankly, no discovery should have been required with no answer from the colluding Stark State, nor the judge's own ruling on the dismissal. Why would anyone turn any privacy info over with no such ruling? That's crazy. So what were they up to with everyone who tried their darnest previously? Per a review of Judge John Adams' cases from January 1st, 2017 to January 1st, 2019, there were a total of approximately 503 cases assigned to Adams' court. And of the employment discrimination, work-related personal injury, and civil rights matters, there were approximately 135 similarly situated cases before this court. Many of these cases included Judge Adams providing a defendant deadline to submit their answer prior to scheduling any forthcoming case management conference, CMC. Why was mine being scheduled prior to the defendant's answering? Rhetorical question duly noted. What is statistically significant in this analysis is that, contrary to Judge Adams' contention of routine practice, only two cases proceeded to the CMC without the necessitated defendant answer. So these two cases included mine, Allen versus Stark State College, with a skewed docket and opinions, and another case. And guess who the opposing counsel was for this secondary victimized litigant? Brennan Manna and Diamond. Dan Ruderi. If this doesn't raise skepticism of bias, it's unlikely that anything will. However, the recordings of the case and its proceedings, and the only requiring me to be present at hearings, not over a dozen defendants to which were all local, I was not. I had zero income to travel and was informed by an airline that I could not travel because I was sick at the time, and this was pre-virus. It didn't matter. Adams was caught knee-deep in this corruption. This is the proverbial politically oppressive, use one of the three statutes to crazy make an individual who dares speaks up. They'll send the Big Bar Esquire to scare you and threaten you. So here's the second federal judge, Pamela Barker, who was speciously assigned to my case after the first judge, the angry Judge Adams, was caught lying and participating in this criminal syndicate racket. Judge Barker had taken her first oath, which I believe was only her Article 1 oath, where the Article 1 courts are placements in venues that are violating our unalienable rights. They're not telling us they placed us in this Article 1 territory either. We think we're in an Article 3, adhering to our unalienable rights. Barker further refused to confirm or deny my Article 1 suspicion and played word salad in her reply. I have reason to believe that our attorneys are the individuals placing us in these Article 1 courts because they must cooperate with their private management secret society organizations rather than abide to vociferously representing us, their clients. Judge Barker was caught conducting the same crimes as Judge Adams, Judge Enloe, the clerks, too many to name. When I requested her commission regarding her jurisdiction to be assured of Article 3 authenticity rather than Article 1 placement, like Judge Adams, she got very angry and threatened me not to contact the courts, which I rarely did. Now, on October 3rd, 2019, with an apparent lifelong appointment with this handy-dandy Article 3 power, Judge Barker, whose seeming cooperation since her first oath in June, is afforded this delayed Article 3 oath and its lifelong security.
And what does she do? She abuses it on her first day. When a motion was submitted to the courts in my case, which was due, she considered that contacting the courts and sent the violent fugitive task force to my Ohio property to intimidate me for, wait for it, filing a motion. To date, the U.S. Marshals also refused to supply their authenticated jurisdictional documentation that allegedly warranted this trespass, harassment, abuse, and intimidation on the 10-year ceremonial memorial of my son's death. If you haven't seen my de facto police video, that will awaken many. So one must question, what was in the commission packet on June 18, 2019? Inquiring minds, yet she refuses to provide any documentation of the authentication of her jurisdiction. Was she wearing an Article 1 hat from June to October and obedient to her beholders, as Mike Lee seemed to be hinting here?
The plaintiff's day in court, which is great. The plaintiff should have the plaintiff's day in court. If in fact there are genuine issues of material fact. But we don't ever want judges to decide in advance that because it's easier or not immediately appealable, they'll do it one way or another. So we'll start with you, Judge Parker. How do you guard against that? And as you handle your civil and your the civil side of your docket.
Well, certainly my background as a lawyer was in civil litigation, so I prepared myself many summary judgment motions and filed those. Been successful at many, but unsuccessful at others. As a judge these past several years, I love the research and writing. I love to write opinions. That's one of my fortes. It's what I enjoy doing, so to speak. So I never go into a situation like that pre-deciding what the issues or whether there is a genuine issue of material fact. I read all the briefs. I make sure I read the depositions. I read and review all the evidence attached thereto. And then I write the opinion. I think the best thing I can do for litigants on both sides is to make sure that I explain to them or let them know by my opinion that I have read everything. I have, in fact, pulled up additional case law, even if they haven't cited it.
Because I'm showing you it right here in black and white that Chief Justice Jay was questioning it back then. How are you having one man appointed to two different offices? This is what you hear a lot of people in the movement. They say that the judges wear two hats. They wear an Article 1 hat and they wear an Article 3 hat. This is how you come in and say, well, okay, he is an Article 3 judge. Or yeah, he is an Article 3 judge, but he's not. You don't have an Article 1 hat. He's operating under an Article, he don't have an Article 3 hat on. He's operating from a delegation of authority from Article 1.
And he was right, and he was right. And his tenure on the court proved to be short-lived in any event. And he was right, and he was right. And his tenure on the court proved to be short-lived in any event. And he was right, and he was right. And his tenure on the court proved to be short-lived in any event.
Did she cooperate with these directives in a quid pro quo deal to be slated for her secondary oath protections? So allow us to review Barker's festivities with my life after years of the defendants and Ohio government conspiring on your taxpayer dollars with my rapist. Yes, those emails exist. June 18, 2019, Barker receives the mysterious packet, her commission. I have yet to receive this. June 19th, a day later, she recites her first oath. Again, I suspect it's Article 1. On July 1st, 2019, she pretty much cleans the slate of all of Judge Adams' unlawful directives. At this point, they think I'll fall for this ominous transition, but they knew I had time to file for her disqualification. 2 weeks later, Judge Barker rules that I'm the only party that cannot file electronically. Only me. Exactly 1 week after this disparate treatment ruling, validating Barker's discrimination, I give notice that I will be moving to disqualify her. It is received, filed, and stamped on July 25th, 2019. 1 day later, Judge Barker dismisses my case. She has also blocked access to other documents on the docket substantiating her ongoing lies and corruption. But hey, cooperate and you will soon receive a lifelong appointment and American Inns of Court prestige. Reputational capitalism at its best. She's categorically, unequivocally 100% busted. I did my due diligence knowing the Sixth Circuit is in bed with this scheme. And I filed to vacate her let's all be friends slate to dismissal, marathon-like closure. And within 3 days of my filing for a treason investigation, Barker receives her investiture, what I assume to be her Article 3 oath, which seals the lifelong deal of employment. On October 3rd, 2019, she was quite the busy beaver that morning. Her investiture, calling the U.S. Marshals, or were they the U.S. Marshals, or some de facto organization? They were ordered to call 5 times, send a couple of texts, leave a voicemail, and ambush my home, all in the name of intimidation. Did they miss the memo? I mean, are they frequenting Wexner's property on a regular basis? Because I'm receiving tons of calls that this task force is ambushing the homes of victims and witnesses who dare report. There are many of us on the receiving end of this, quite possibly, de facto fake task force. They might get in a few violent fugitives in there once in a while to give the appearance of propriety. In a true republic, all of these judges would be prosecuted and incarcerated in accordance with our supreme law of the land. No one is above the law. Always remember, fraud vitiates all. No statutes of limitation. Stop thinking in their contrived sandbox.
Woe to those who decree iniquitous decrees, and the writers who keep writing oppression, to turn aside the needy from justice, and to rob the poor of my people of their right, that widows may be their spoil, and that they may make the fatherless their prey. What will you do on the day of punishment, in the ruin that will come from afar? To whom will you flee for help, and where will you leave your wealth? Nothing remains but to crouch among the prisoners or fall among the slain.
Wake up, Ohio, when you put me up, tell me down, you got me stuck here in this bone dry town. Wake up, Ohio, when you put me up, put me down, all these memories falling all around. Woke up in this cold, dark town, and there was no one around, no one around. Hollow faces are staring me down, sisters are staring me down, hollow voices resound.
To a 911 call about an SUV that drove into a ditch while getting onto I-76 during a snowstorm Sunday night. The driver identifies herself as Portage County Common Pleas Court Judge Rebecca Becky Doherty.
I'm Becky Doherty. I'm the judge.
You're a judge? So this is what we're going to do, okay? I'm going to take you, we're going to put you in the cruiser. I'm going to take you back to the department where we'll do the testing there because, again, this is in a safe area.
I don't care.
Judge Doherty, who was a former prosecutor, becomes emotional when the officer places her under arrest for suspicion of operating a vehicle while under the influence.
Are you kidding me?
Am I kidding about what?
I am absolutely out of my mind with...
You're intoxicated.
I am so intoxicated, but...
According to Brimfield Police, Judge Doherty refused to take a breathalyzer test,
which under Ohio law could result in a one-year suspension of her driver's license.
Rebecca, I'm going to fire up the BAC. Are you going to be willing to do a breathalyzer test?
No, you need to call.
Okay. Rebecca, I'm going to ask you one more time, and this is going to be considered refusal. Are you going to be willing to perform a breathalyzer test?
No.
Okay.
While in the booking area of the police department, Judge Doherty indicates that she would like to call Major Larry Limbert of the Portage County Sheriff's Office and becomes agitated when the officer tells her that her cell phone is still in the SUV.
What's the deal?
What's the deal with what?
Give me my phone so I can make a phone call.
Okay. Your phone is in a puddle of vomit in your car, which is
I
on the side
it.
Of... Can I finish? Absolutely. Which is on the side of the road that you crashed into.
Yes.
After Becky Doherty was booked on the OVI charge, her daughter arranged to get the judge a ride.
This is how they have mentally controlled us. The compliance, the obedience. Okay, whatever you say. These public servants cannot grant themselves unjust powers, such as indemnification and immunity. But we know how they're getting away with it, don't we? Bogus criminal charges that were put in place to silence us. Additionally, if there were litigation, I've repeatedly informed Altman that your law firm is conflicted. Allow me to share a pictorial narrative for you, as it seems reading comprehension is not one of your areas of expertise. These four attorneys are former Day Ketterer lawyers, which was my rapist law firm, and mysteriously closed. Why is that strange? Well, as Ohio's oldest law firm, they apparently house representation. Now what does this logo remind me of? I'm sure it's just a coincidence. Anyhow, it appears you attempted to repeatedly contact me in 2020, incessantly violating my cease and desist notification. Now it's 2021, and I received the strangest voicemail from you threatening me not to ask my healthcare provider for my records, or else. I'm sorry, but I'm not a foreign bar agent, but this sounds remotely like intimidation of a victim witness, extortion, coercion, harassment, obstructing justice. And it doesn't appear that this is your law firm's first rodeo attempting to extort victims of Altman who dare serve as victims or whistleblowers.
Altman employee explained decedent's printouts were not part of his medical record because the nursing staff had not provided them to the medical records department. She did not know who directed the nurses to print decedent's data. She explained if a record or document is not given to the medical records department, that record or document is not made part of the patient's medical record, even if another part of the hospital may have a copy. So you can put it in the second stall of the woman's bathroom on the sixth floor when someone requests it because it's not in the office tangibly at that point. Therein, Ranieri averred she worked exclusively under the authority, direction, control, and supervision of Altman's legal department. The risk management department operates under the direction of attorney Mark N. Rose, the senior vice president of legal affairs and system risk management. There is sufficient basis to believe that Altman is in possession of additional medical records not produced. Go figure. So let me be very clear to you, Mr. Brown. You don't scare me. I'm no longer that girl from 7 years ago that big bad Esquire called me. I know the gig. I know the matrix. I know about secret societies and private management associations that secure people like you. The egotistical, arrogant, misogynistic, maniacal elitist who think they are superior. While your mother might disagree, newsflash, you're not. You can't provide yourself with unjust powers. You can't usurp powers from other branches. Your bar buddies have done specifically that. Even creating new constitutions in Ohio to the unwitting victims in their court. Who knew? Silly me. From my Rockefeller-mandated education, checks and balances, separations of powers. So while you play in this contrived sandbox of alleged immunity, in the real world where no one's above the law, de jure exists, and you don't have that unwielding power. So keep your imaginary land, and I will decline jurisdiction and validate that even when you try to exert this premise, I will never consent to your viper venues. Not in a box, not with a fox, not in a ship, admiralty pun intended, not with a whip, enslavement, ambiguity intended. Okay, I'll stop. But even if that alternative venue jurisdiction were to be used to attempt to hoodwink me into a non-consensual situation, I'll prove to you that government implicitly admitted to the de jure in an intriguing predicament acknowledging the missing 13th Amendment, where esquires should be non-existent in governmental positions due to their conflicting oaths. We all know you can't serve two masters, but many of the barfia actually serve three or more. Who knew? So allow me to be very clear. I am done with your organized cabal criminal syndicate silencing me. I will report. I will contact my health provider when necessitated. You don't threaten me. I will not consent to your administrative, Masonic, corporate, privatized, sovereign citizen, and or domestic terrorist de facto jurisdiction. To be clear, I am not an estate, chattel property, a transmitting utility, a British or Vatican subject, an employee of the state of Ohio, or any other corporation purporting to do business as part of the government. I'm not a SSUK trust, a vessel, a lost or misplaced cargo, a corporate fiction person, a corporation, a subject, participant in experimentation, a dead body, or a slave. Even if one were to use this illogical sociopathic rationalization of a straw man, one could argue abuse of a corpse. But I digress. So, for the umpteenth time, Tony and law firm, do not, and I repeat, do not contact me again. Not by letter, email, telegram, paper, stork, or drone. My very minimal emails and recorded calls over the past 3 years to my healthcare provider is not harassment, which we all know is one of the several tactics used by this corrupt barfia to politically oppress victims and witnesses.
Talking to me, saying, who do you think you are? See, I'm just a nobody.